That sounds like a keyboard.
Yeah.
Make it sound like a keyboard, yeah, with the swelling things, yeah. It could, it throws cool ambient stuff.
Yeah.
That's a cool thing about it, you can really get that, like.
Yeah.
I'm doing fine. I just welcome to you.
I heard you did a summer. You're inspiring me. I have to think of something to do for a summer camp, summer science camp, and I, maybe I'll do it this year.
That was fun. Sounded pretty good out here. I mean, you know, it can be dialed in for sure a little bit better, but that's pretty good for just real quick doing it, you know? Yeah. Has that been good?
Yep.
Okay.
It's good.
Well, I can buy the tickets, but it's.
Well, you can buy the tickets. I want some tickets.
How much are they? You know, we.
They're a lot of money.
How much?
$8.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Somebody else.
Nice to see you.
Hi, what do you want?
Hey, Mom. Do you
want to
buy it?
Yes, we'll probably buy four.
You want to buy
it? $8.
Although I guess we're buying three of them. But not right this second. You can't at home here.
$8.
No, that's my mom. Please, you're on the 8th.
Hi.
How are you?
It's he.
Good.
It was
now.
Good.
It went good.
You did it upstairs when there was tons of people.
Well, just, I know.
And now you're in the middle of the aisle.
No, it's not. I don't want to.
It's so funny.
Now they're like,
yeah, like there's four people here.
No, we don't
want to
do it.
You guys are silly.
We just walk around. We have a
oh, somebody changed the flowers. They changed them?
Did I change the flowers? No.
I don't pay attention. I guess I'm looking that way. Well, like you said, I'm not looking over here. We're right there. I just told
what is it?
Oh, meat enamel. What is it?
I need
it's a candy.
I need to remember what's up there.
You don't have to eat it. What is it?
Y'all taste like animal parts.
Yeah.
This is my daughter, Lisa.
Some of those are.
I was just going to do that for three times.
Yeah.
Three years at the health department uptown here.
You're in a very light area. I found this. Mom, I found it here. Anyway.
I told you. I went and saw Corey the other day.
I know.
Hey, Mom.
She had to go. I said, we need to get it over with, you know. She said, well, don't wait by the phone. A half hour later, she called me back and said, no, I did it. I washed it twice and dried it. It was still,
thank you.
But it's a whole lot 80% better.
Mom, Mind you, I popped.
Oh, yes, I found these stories. Did she tell you
about
it? Oh. She went into her place to buy some stuff to see what to do. And this guy was back there. And he seems to care what he's written about. And I was she says, I kind of got overtoned. Yeah, I can tell. So she says, what are you going to do? Because she's all that's hard to And so he's, well, we'll get some soap, wash it once, maybe twice.
And oh, yeah, that's right. Who's gonna do it? I didn't know you had it. So you're gonna do it again, right?
They're nervous about it because there's so many
people.
I don't want to do it. No, because what if they say no?
There you go. I got some money for it. How about that?
What if they say no?
Then you just say, okay, thanks.
I won't want to do it. I guess I'll do it. Okay, you can see it.
No, you just put it into the basket.
That's what you have to do.
Usually we just walk around and take it.
No, you don't have to say anything.
Me and Leah just walk around.
Guys,
you don't have
it's
to
an
say
opportunity.
Anything.
Oh.
You don't say anything.
You want to go to
But it's an opportunity. You're going to be older and immature, and somebody's going to need to do this, and you'll say,
I'll do it.
Let's do it.
I'll do it.
It's not a big game. Well, you go around and ask for tickets, so you sell tickets. You can go do that.
Thank you.
Well, good morning, all. Welcome to worship today. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray that this will be a time where, whether you're right here or you're watching the service online, it's our hope and prayer that the Holy Spirit will stir in your hearts and you'll know that God loves you, forgives you, and is with you wherever you are. I do want to lift up just a few announcements. I know we're very concerned about the folks of Ukraine and needing to keep them in prayer. The war has led to a humanitarian crisis, and there's the good news, if there is any, is that the United Methodist Church is already on the ground there. And we have churches there, and there's quite a presence of United Methodism in the country. And the churches are providing shelter for those that are needing to flee where their homes are or were. And churches are providing shelter for the people. There's a quote that I'd like to share from the bishop who at the United Methodist Church over there, who is both bishop in Ukraine and in Russia. You can imagine that job right now. He says, "There is a war in Europe. Russia has invaded Ukraine, which is a free, independent democracy. War and violence are evil and always entail considerable human costs. The Christian message points to the path of reconciliation and never to war and violence as a solution to conflicts. We stand with United Methodists in Ukraine in prayer for protection, reconciliation, and peace." End of quote. If you're wondering about ways that maybe you can help when we feel so helpless as far away, there are a couple of ways. I think we have a few of these. Yeah, they're up here with Heather, and there may be some over there. UMCOR is United Methodist Committee on Relief. It is an organization that gets boots on the ground right away. It gets people there to help. And there is a special offering they have once a year for any kind of disaster or emergency around the world, and this covers administrative costs as well as startup costs of getting to a place so they can get people there right away. You can give with this, or if you have, writing out checks, you can write to the Kewanee First United Methodist Church and in the memo put Ukraine, and then we'll be able to get 100% of your offering to go towards emergency relief. So that's an option too. A couple other things I want to mention is with some of the changes in the state mandate and what we've been doing through our denomination, starting next week, if you're already there, that's perfectly fine. We do want to be respectful of those that have, are vulnerable and need, people to be in mass around them if they can. But starting next week, mass will be optional. So we'll just leave it at that. And you just kind of have to see the people you're around, the situations you're in, what you're comfortable with. Also, you might have seen some posters around. We are going to be doing the Easter drive-through again for children and families. And it will be on April 9th. And they do need lots of volunteers to help get ready for that. So there's setup and there's being there for the event itself. And tear down afterwards. And also, if you're interested and would like to be involved with that, please let me know or let the office know, and we'll make sure that we get you plugged in where you'd like to serve. All right. I hope that right now we can just pause, breathe, and have this opportunity right now to just focus on God and let God speak to our hearts today as we worship. So let's begin now. We're gonna sing Our God. So let's just stand and sing with all your hearts. during these moments in our worship, we want to set this aside as your time with God, your time to be able to share what's been happening in your life and your relationship with God. And if you have prayer concerns, or if you just want to share a God moment that you've experienced recently or this past week, we want to give you a chance to do that. So it's your someone that has something that God's put on your heart that you'd like to share today. It's a blessing to see Connie up here, who's very active at the church in Geneseo, where we came from, and is at Care Center here. I forget, which place is it now?
Grace Methodist.
Yeah, Grace Methodist. Which Care Center are you living in now?
Kiwani.
Okay, it is the Kiwani Care Center, so we're delighted that you're here for worship today.
Well, Kiwani Courtyard.
Oh, okay. All right, Kiwani Courtyard. Okay. Well, anyways, praise God that you're worshiping here today.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay, I got one.
I'll just pass the mic for you. I guess I have praise, and it's very simple. I really like this time of year. It just springs on its way, and it's sort of a relief from winter. Anybody else? Praises or concerns? Keep counting, Kelly, right?
So it's just the little things of life. So we were on the way to one of my doctor's appointments, and there was this semi that pulled right out in front of us, and I'm thinking, oh my goodness, we're already late, we're not gonna make it there. And for some reason, I'm not kidding you, the semi pulled over, we went, and he pulled right back on, just like it was meant to be. Like, God is like, hey, you're not gonna be late, you're just fine. And the other day I went to work, and we had this cake that we had to do with this motorcycle. And we have tons of papers you got to go through, and just because I hadn't been feeling well, I forgot to pull it out for the cake lady. And so I come walking out of the office, and she goes, I can't find that motorcycle. And I said, okay. I said, let me help you. So I started going through it, and as soon as I said, okay, Jesus, we can't find it, we were down to the very nitty-gritty. She had one left in her hand, and I had maybe five. And right then, as soon as I said, Lord, please help me find that, there it was. So I said, you know, I looked right at her, I was like, hell, I prayed about it. That's why we found that.
I've got a little bit of both. Praises, we have a prayer board upstairs, and today we were looking at it, and we realized that God had answered almost all the prayers on that prayer board already. Of course, we had some things to add on there. We want to keep the Copelands in prayer for many different reasons. Diane's mom has passed away this week as well, and so we want to lift them up in prayer. Keep praying for the Andersons, Grandma Judy. She's doing better. That's another answered prayer. And I have some upcoming tests that I would appreciate all the prayer that we could get for.
I just recently got a volunteer job at Salvation Army, and it's a wonderful people to work with.
Okay. Anybody?
And these concerns I do want to lift up now as we have a time of prayer, but I also want to mention to you at the close of this service, any of you that would like to stay for just a couple of minutes, we wanted to have prayer with Carrie and have healing prayer for her. Say get ready to make this trip. They'll be leaving next Sunday, so they're around this week. And so there will be youth group all this week, tonight and Wednesday, but then next Sunday they'll be gone, so there won't be any youth Sunday night or next Wednesday is they or be traveling back about that time on Wednesday. Is that right? On Thursday. Okay. So, but we do want to have this time of prayer with Gary after the service today. So let's go to God in prayer. Oh Lord, we marvel at the beauty of your creation. The sun this morning, the mountains, the sky, the oceans, we are overwhelmed at the vastness of your universe. And that as small as we are, that you are mindful of us, and that you love us, and that you have given us the gift of life, the gift of faith. And your one desire for us is that we learn to love you, to love one another, to love the most vulnerable, and to love our enemies as we love ourselves. We thank you, Lord, for the beauty we see in the simple things, for the small prayers that seem to get answered and getting places on time, getting you just seem to sometimes pave the way for us to get where we need to be. And we thank you for the simple things like the sunrise and the smiling faces of our loved ones and their hugs, their laughter, good friends, good food, good conversation. We are so grateful. And we're grateful that you call us together to be the church, to be family, to learn together how to care for one another, how to build each other up, how to pray, how to grow stronger in our faith. Help us to be open to one another. Help us to know that we are stronger together. Help us to turn over our worries and our fears to you. Lord, we do pray for our world. We pray especially for the people of Ukraine. We don't claim to understand the complexities of nations and leaders far from us, but we cry out for the children, for the families, for the people that are in harm's way, and we pray for our own troops that stand ready and for their families that are afraid, for sons and daughters, for moms and dads, for our servicemen and women that have dangerous work to do. We pray, Lord, for peace. And we do want to lift up the Copelands in this time of grief. We pray for Diane and for the whole family as they grieve the loss of her mom. And we pray, Lord, that you will heal the hurts of the journey that they've made over this last many weeks of walking with her mom through very difficult days. And we pray, Lord, that you will continue to draw near to them in this time of grief. We pray for Kelly as she continues to await tests and treatment and help with the pain that she's been experiencing. And we just pray, Lord, she'll get some answers soon. And we pray for Carrie and Chris as they make this trip to Texas. And we especially lift up Carrie to you today, that your healing power will continue to be at work in her. And that you will just give her a sense of peace and calm as she goes through these tests. And we just pray that there will be a good outcome from the tests that she has to go through this week. Lord, we thank you for good news. Prayers answered, that we can look at the prayer board and we can see that prayers have been answered. And we praise you and thank you for that. We thank you that Katie has this job at Salvation Army and that she's got a lot of good people to work with. And we just thank you that she's going to have this opportunity and to be able to serve with others and to put her faith into practice as she volunteers there. And we just lift up all these prayers to you, Lord, and knowing that you do hear our prayers and you do answer them, not always in the way we expect, and not on our timing always, but you do answer and give us courage and hope and joy along the way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I want to share with you the scripture for today. I want to share with you, starting next week, we're going to do try to do a few different things in worship. And one is that we're wanting you all to have a chance to be a little more involved. We hate that there's quite so much time where you just kind of, you know, you're listening to me. So at the tables, we're going to have the scripture reading there. And we'll have a volunteer at the table that will read the scripture for the table. We'll experiment. We may also have where everybody has a copy and read it together so it doesn't put anybody on the spot. And hopefully have some other things that you'll be involved with during this Lent, which starts next Sunday. We have Ash Wednesday service this Wednesday, traditional service upstairs in the sanctuary at 6. And that'll begin our Lent together. And if you have questions, well, what's Lent? It's a good, you know, coming Wednesday night's a good way to kind of get an introduction to it. But it is the 6 weeks plus Sundays leading up to Easter and us being in preparation. So there'll be some things for you to do at the table. But today I'm going to read the scripture that comes from the Gospel of Luke. It says, about 8 days after Jesus said these things, he took Peter, John, and James and went up on the mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes flashed white like lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, were talking with him. They were clothed with heavenly splendor and spoke about Jesus' departure, which he would achieve in Jerusalem. Peter and those with him were almost overcome by sleep, but they managed to stay awake and saw his glory as well as the two men with him. As the two men were about to leave Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it's good that we're here. We should construct 3 shrines, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." But he didn't know what he was saying. Peter was still speaking when a cloud overshadowed them. As they entered the cloud, they were overcome with awe. Then a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." Even as the voice spoke, Jesus was found alone. They were speechless and at that time told no one that they had what they had seen. God always blesses the reading and hearing of his holy word. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, I grew up in southern Illinois in Carbondale, and we had snow, but not like the snowfalls up here. When I was a teenager, I remember at night going outside because it was snowing, and it was coming down hard, and it was the best kind of packing snow, the best kind of snow for making snowmen, so that's what I was doing. In the middle of my creative work, I saw the sky glow. It started out kind of dim, and it got brighter and brighter and brighter, and then it went down. And about a minute later, it did it again. Well, since you all live up north here, you might have seen this and know that that was, you know, lightning in a snowstorm. But I'd never seen it before. And so there were 2 thoughts kind of came into my mind. One was, this was either a nuclear explosion or it was lightning in a snowstorm. And the reaction of my body was, the feeling that I went through is that I wanted to either bow down or I wanted to, well, go inside. And so I actually did both. I bowed down really quickly, and then I went inside. And this experience really has had quite an impact on me. I know I've shared it probably too many times in my sermons. I don't know, Connie's probably heard me tell the story before, but I can count on one hand of having experiences like this, of seeing the sunrise on the Grand Canyon, of being in the Himalayas in Nepal, and a few years ago, seeing a total eclipse of the sun down in southern Illinois. You may remember when that took place. I think I understand what primitive people felt like when they saw their first thunderstorm or their first eclipse or saw a rainbow. Because what you want to do is either bow down or run away. You don't know what to do. Well, Jesus takes his inner circle of disciples up on the mountain to pray. Peter, James, and John. And I want you to hear the scripture again for today in the Gospel of Luke. It says, as he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes flashed white like lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, were talking with him. They were clothed with heavenly splendor and spoke about Jesus' departure, which he would achieve in Jerusalem. Peter and those with him were almost overcome by sleep, but they managed to stay awake, which is probably what a lot of us do when there's a really long prayer, we get sleepy. But they stayed awake. And they saw his glory, as well as the two men with him. As the two men were about to leave Jesus, Peter said to him, Master, it's good that we're here. We should construct three shrines, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. But he didn't know what he was saying. Peter was still speaking when a cloud overshadowed them. As they entered the cloud, they were overcome with awe. Now, the scripture says that Peter wanted to build these three shrines or booths, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for Jesus. But the scripture says he didn't know what he was saying. Exactly. I have a lot of sympathy for Peter. He was brash. He was bold. He often spoke out of turn, spoke without thinking. But sometimes he got it right, and as far as I'm concerned, this was one of the times he got it right. He was overwhelmed with what he was seeing, what he was experiencing, and he wanted to do something in response, to bow down in worship, to mark the moment, to mark the experience. They saw something they couldn't explain. Jesus, filled with light, radiating like the sun. And these two other figures that somehow they recognized as Moses and Elijah, that represent the law and the prophets. And they were in a conversation about Jesus' departure that he would accomplish in Jerusalem. Now, you know what they're talking about here, right? Moses and Elijah are talking to Jesus about his departure, his death in Jerusalem, his plan, God's plan to defeat death and to put in place God's plan to save the world. It's the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. Now, Peter's response of wanting to build something, to do something, seems in keeping with what the disciples had experienced and what some of the giants of faith of our faith have done all along. I think of Jacob who has this dream, a vision of a ladder going up and down from heaven and angels ascending and descending to earth. And it says that after having this dream, the scripture says, Jacob got up early in the morning. He took the stone that he had put near his head, set it up as a sacred pillar, and poured oil on top of it. He believed that this was the dwelling place of God. Moses. And the people constructed a tent of meeting. And every time he went there to pray and entered into the Lord's presence, he returned to the people, and he was glowing so brightly that he had to wear a veil to shield their eyes. And Elijah, well, Elisha witnesses Elijah going up to heaven in a chariot of fire, and he does two things. One is he tears his own cloak in two, and then he picks up Elijah's cloak and puts it on himself. And in that act, he takes on the spirit of Elijah and God's spirit dwelling within him. Of course, Peter didn't know what to do or say in response to what he was experiencing. But he was in good company with these giants of our faith that all experienced the power and presence of God in a way that was beyond understanding. But that wasn't all. While Peter is rattling on about what they should do, the scripture says, Peter was still speaking when a cloud overshadowed them. As they entered the cloud, they were overcome with awe. Then a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." 8 days before, Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am? And who do you say that I am?" And Peter replied, "You are the Christ. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." 8 days before, Jesus explained to the disciples that he had to go to Jerusalem, and there he would be arrested, tried, convicted, and crucified. And on the third day, would rise from the dead. And the disciples wanted none of it. God comes to Jesus and to this inner circle of his disciples, and he shows up in a cloud of light, and they hear God's voice saying, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." God confirms Jesus' plan that he shared with his disciples 8 days earlier, that he must go to Jerusalem and be crucified. Now, if they were dragging their feet before about going to Jerusalem, if they weren't on board with what Jesus was doing and where Jesus was going, being in that cloud of light, hearing the voice of God was surely enough to convince them. What does God tell the disciples to do? Listen to him. Listen to Jesus. And immediately after God spoke, Jesus was there alone. No more vision, no more light in the sky, just Jesus. Jesus and the disciples came down from the mountain and were back with the other disciples and all the other problems and challenges that were before them. There's a father that brought a son to be healed, but the disciples couldn't heal him. The disciples continued their long journey with Jesus, and then they argued with each other about who was the greatest. They tried to find lodging in a Samaritan village, but they were not welcome to stay because Jesus was focused on going to Jerusalem. And when they got to Jerusalem, Jesus broke down and cried, seeing the city, and crying out for the people that he loved, because he knew that they were going to reject him. The inner circle of Jesus' disciples had experienced this great thing on the mountaintop. But they came down from the mountain with just Jesus, and with the same mess, the same problems they had before: lack of faith, lack of vision, competition, jealousy, and fear. fear of the unknown. And maybe you've been fortunate enough to have a mountaintop experience, a moment of complete awe. You went to a Christian conference. You were on walk to Emmaus. You were in a small group where everyone prayed over you. You got to see your favorite Christian musician live in concert. You came to Christmas Eve service, candlelight, singing Silent Night. You saw lightning in a snowstorm. You saw a double rainbow. You were overwhelmed with the love, the awe, the presence of God all around you. And then it was over. And you had to return to real life, just as messy and confusing and difficult as it was before. It's just Jesus alone who said, "I will never leave you or forsake you." Just Jesus, here to help us make the most of the normal times when nothing much is happening and our faith is weak and our prayer life is sporadic and life is hard. Just Jesus alone, the constant, the faithful one, who had his focus on Jerusalem to give his life, who now has his focus on you and me and this messed up world to love us and redeem us. Just Jesus. And it's enough. It's more than enough. Just Jesus and this one little instruction from God. What does God say to do in response to Jesus? Listen to him. Listen to him. Amen.
As you were able. And of course, sing along, enjoy this song as much as we do. Revelations.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
The grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit go with you and be with you all. Amen.
Amen.
Everybody.